All right. So I've made a offline. I made a few refinements to the material. First of all, it now returns a full fragment descriptor, so I got rid of that out of the application. All that's left is the vertex descriptor. It now instead, the material is retrieved, so we get the fragment descriptor straight from the material now. Pass that into the pipeline pool. So that's a movement. That's a movement. It's a thing in the right direction, I suppose, is the what I was trying to say, which is good. So now I need to. There's two other things I. Well, yeah. There's two other things I needed to do for the material loader, or maybe it's like a material unloader. I'm not entirely sure. Whatever the case may be, I need a mechanism to safely unload the material or its items. No, yeah, it's starting from the material. I need to unload it in a few frames in the future, since I can have them and everything that it relies upon in flight for another couple of already submitted but not rendered frames. So I'm going to need something to deal with that. It's probably going to require me to go ahead and probably blah blah. Probably it'll be just a probably something just simple, standard mutex. So I need to change from maintenance to like process load requests. Unload requests. Because what's probably going to happen is I can't have them together, like in a one maintenance, because the idea is going to be what I have for materials, or I should say, resources can be loaded at any time, like on any main tick, because like you're just throwing up the process to start it. Like it's not tied per to a frame render necessarily. But unloading is tied to frames, tied to the frame index or the frame tick, I should say, like. We need to wait until like at least three more frames have been rendered. So we loop back around to the same one that would have been the last one to have these resources in use. So what I'm going to do, process load requests that, and then I've got to fix up, well, yeah, shader loading in a moment as well. But what we're going to do is we are going to request resource load. We'll do this. That means we also need like a standard. Now, I don't have access to the foam material itself because presumably in order to stop using it on the frame that I'm trying to unload this, I need to also blank out like the fragment descriptor. I need to blank out the loaded source. So by the time I get ra come back around, I won't have this information. So I'm going to need like what was I going to do? Basically, what it would have to be is a struct that I can copy around. So, even though I'm not using the struct in an atomic sense, would still be. this. So what it'll be, flow material data. So I would actually need to have this brought in. Not only that, but it needs to be an array. It has to be a number of arrays because I have like X number of frames worth of items to do. So it's this touch flow graphics max buffered frames. Let's say plus one, actually. We'll always do the number of frames plus one just to be safer. I need type defs. It's this, and then we're going to have a pointer. First of all, this material data stuff is going to play havoc with what I have before. It says load requests. Msync. I'm load sync now. Resource unload, yeah, that stuff. Do that, and then m unload m current. That's right, p. We need P material, material data. It'll be a copy, which is what I want. Now, do I have a lock on this? Data write lock. I need the data write lock on it. Which one is more? This is most likely to be far more contentious than this one. So, yeah, P material, right, data write lock. We do that, and then write lock. Material data equals, we blank it out. Anything else we want to do? No, not really. Oh, and we unload where it's now unloaded as well. P material. Load state. Now there's a chance of it being updated and loaded and then instantly unloaded. But that's just something we're going to have to deal with. One thing we're going to have to do though. It'll have to be this. And that. Do that before we get into the locked area. Data equals material data. Do like a swap? Not really. P material data. If there's some loaded stuff in here, then we need to add it to be removed. Which means, similarly to up here, I think that's all we need is just these two. Nope, that. Send it to be unloaded. Loaded. Whole bunch of things going through my mind as to whether this is actually. Process unload requests. Okay, so for an unload request, it has to be. Loaded. Then we do this. We need to make sure there's actual data in here as well. Well, I'll assume it is, and I can process it later together. Otherwise, we'll just leave, no problems. Okay, processing unload requests. So, I can't do that because I'll be doing other things afterwards. So, m unload sync dot lock. Need to unlock afterwards. What we need to do first is m. Was that? Equals end of M upload unload quest lists unload size. Then it needs to become first one instead. Then that, then we unlock, then we so it's free to add new unload requests for this, And then we have to go on and do a job. Now, I know asynchronous. I mean, does it really? Or do I do it synchronously? I'm not sure. Maybe this will be something I have, like a Boolean blocking or non-blocking or something like that. Well, I'll just always assume it's blocking for now. So we just go through for auto. Currently, there's nothing to do. I'm not actually, because I don't have the shader hooked into the system. So all that's here is fragment descriptors, which exist for the entirety of the program anyways. So not much point to that. No siree. And of course, these can only operate when we're going through to new frames. Process unload requests. I'd also have to do something along the lines during deinitialization where I'll have to like go through all objects, request them to be unloaded. Oh yeah. Then wait a cut and run through a couple of ticks to empty out the system. And then leave. Where's the initialization? It's right about here. So that's the XR stuff. Frame data. So this is like real kind of higher level stuff. So it's about here or here, maybe. I mean, the frame buffers and frame data would eventually be part of resource management. So for the time, I don't really have a mechanism for material management. I just have it loading and unloading, but not actually managing all the materials together, like a large pool of some sort. But I don't want to do like the old pools. I want something a bit smarter. Probably something to do with the ECS again. But oh yeah, I did this last time. I wasn't sure if I wanted to do like a faux resource or faux entity. It's not really entity, it's kind of transient entities. Or above that. Or actually, rather below that. Many entities can reuse a thing. I mean, technically, I already have the IDs by the memory location. That's how I typically move around with them. But if I'm, let's say, saving to file and loading from file, I can't rely on that. Resources need to have their own IDs. And I don't really want to overload the entity space, the entity ID space with a bunch of things. But resources would still have to have groups. So it's grouped by the importing file. Okay, whatever the case may be. We'll go through it twice. I mean, at this point, it's basically free. I can do 100 times to make sure I properly process everything. Coming back out. XR. It's kind of above that. About here. Because XR is still like, yeah. Use of undeclared identifier, p fragment descriptor. You are probably right. Data dot. Okay, we're going to change material data to just data. Okay, right now we still have materials being destroyed despite having active uses. I'm not seeing validation layers being done. Oh, right, because shader is separate. That's right. Okay. The material dot, or rather, request resource unload for the material. Okay, we got that. Comes out. We're in. Doing this, it's loaded, right? Optimized out, very nice. Okay, what I put in though is, I don't know. Oh, right, I'm not gonna get anything here. Yay, and we went through, then we supposedly would have deleted it, and then we're clean and clear and happy and all that stuff. So if I want to get rid of this message, first of all, I need to... decrement use count. added a framework for material unloading. One thing I do need to do though. Okay, let that work through the system, OCI, then next will be, I can either move down or I can do work on the asynchronous stuff. Honestly, I should probably do asynchronous. Because I need to get it sorted out before I settle too deep into a pattern that I figure out. When I do asynchronous, I realize, hey, none of this works. I got to redo it all. So I need some kind of thing to for asynchronous. I need like a thread pool of some sort. Which I guess I can put under foe. Okay. Thread. Condition variable will include mutex. Just a basic one, I guess. We need a private thread running function. Number of threads to start. Size of the pool. Terminate Schedule a job. Is it a job or task? Job is filled with many tasks, whereas a task is not necessarily a job. I'll say task. It will move semantics. Whether they've been started, we have a list or vector of standard thread. We need to synchronize tasks. Vector really good for this? I don't think so. Probably a queue. Queue goes one. Do I want a double-ended queue? Queue. Variable. Task complete. Okay. We have atomics and mutexes, so the copy and move constructors and operators are already dead. So we need from that. Red pool. Gold slouch. Okay. actually, on termination, we want to be able to make sure we go through the terminate. False, no, 0, and false. I need to restart for Clang to come back online. There we go, coloration's back. Terminate. Got that. It's basically the opposite of this. Otherwise, we just return. So that to be true, complete task complete condition, notify all, no, it be task available. We go into the threads, tell them all there's a task available, even though there isn't. They'll go through until they hit the exit point. Wait for all tasks. for the mole to join. They reset. Schedule. In place. Move for task. Put it on the notify one, anyone who's listening and waiting for one, waiting for a task. Really, I should just do that and then notify. Wait for all tasks means what do we need to do? Just. To be blocking, so task complete. We're waiting on this guy, so we'll wait on the lock with reference. This is when we leave that end and tasks processing equals zero. It requires a unique lock. Sorry. Now to run, okay, we need something local. So this will be local, this will just be a reused variable all the time. exec function. Is there a way to do unique lock where we start off unlocked? Whoops, nope, nobody uses that. There you are. Defer lock 3, 4. Does not lock the associated mutex. Okay, looks like that'll do it. all true. Task available. I'm going to wait on the task lock for either a task to be available or termination has been requested. We got work, so increment that, then later decrement it. There's a front. Pop is, I presume, from the front. For Q, I think. First element. Front. Okay, end, front, pop. Does pop actually return the thing? No, just pops it. We'll unlock the git work. Release that, then exec the function. Then we're done. No. When we're done, we just go mTaskComplete.notify all, I guess. Anyone who's waiting for this command. Else, if. Then it comes back through, locks, waits for the thing, and then carries on. We run through each time as long as there's a task available. Then, once there are no more tasks, then we try and terminate. Break out. Otherwise, we're here. We're here for some reason. There was an actual task. We're not terminating, so we just. Task lock to unlock. So you'll still be locked if we're going through this. Task lock will also be unlocked when we leave. If the task is empty, then we do this. Else. Otherwise, it's not empty. That means we could just go here and just do... We can skip waiting for something. We could just kind of do a faster... Hey, it's not empty. The carry-on. Should probably add a test offline for this as well, but for the moment, some core stuff. Asynchronous thread pool. Technically, we'd have two. We'll have two thread pools, asynchronous, asynchronous. I need the ability to get hardware concurrency. I think that's just standard from thread. Auto joining. That's new. JThread. Okay, JThread is almost guaranteed not to be implemented in some environments right now. So just stick the regular thread. As much as I would want to use it. These guys. So then one of the very last things we do is after that. Terminate the thread pools. Otherwise, it's one of the first things we do. Yes. Okay. Material. Here. Material loader. Here we go. Standard function equals what? Be a reference to something in here, it takes in that, it'll be like Yeah, I think so. So then that would mean going back to material. Loader, here we go. Async jobs. I mean, I guess. And then if this was to seconds, then this will definitely fail, right? It'll fail to load in time, so then the fragment, the pipeline pools will screw it up and whole thing dies. Terrible, terrible accident. Yep. Wait, get built-in layouts. Yeah, because it's a null pointer. The thing I'm in is null. Yeah. Meanwhile, I don't know who's who. He's waiting on something. He's waiting on something. He's the one who's running. And he's empty. Okay. So what I want to do for the moment, though, is part of the load requests. Asynchronous thread pool, then we wait for all tasks. So now he'll wait 5 seconds. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Then he goes on and then he succeeds. Excellent. Now he's async jobs. He doesn't want that. Now this isn't necessarily threaded. It's just running inside. I could always, yeah. Don't need that to do either. Now if there's like a boolean between true and false for whether or not to run these asynchronously or not, I'd rather just keep it that way, actually. It's always asynchronous right now. Okay. Okay, so I got most of the surrounding items for material pool kind of ready. Now I need to either, what I want to do, I can either work on the items below material, so that's fragment, descriptor, and shaders, or I can figure out some kind of safety mechanism so that if fragment descriptor doesn't actually exist, it doesn't render anything. I mean, that's probably pretty easy. Can I continue out of here? Where am I? Am I even in a loop? I am in a very deep loop. Skip draw. This is the XR draw, right? Material. We also got the same thing going on here. Okay, with that out of the way, then I can do synchronous threads. Asynchronous, do not wait. Synchronous threads need to wait for the job to be completed, for the tick to be completed. So that's after all this at the very end of the loop, about here. Synchronous are per tick items. And I did add it to the asynchronous, right? Schedule task. Terminate at the end. Okay. Go. One, two, three, four, five. It's done. It's loaded. It adds in line, in stream, if you will. It's streamed in. Yes. Nice. Eventually, we'll have to do the same thing for vertex descriptor and the pipeline creation. And well, pipeline, the creation, the getting the pipeline requires me to have an active vertex and fragment descriptor anyways. Yeah, anyways, added. Load. Add a fragment descriptor load. Checks. Okay, that's those items kind of dealt with. At this point, I have to go deep, drill down to fragment descriptor and shaders, which I will do in another video. Cheers.